This episode is sponsored by sales of our educational courses available at school.learnlightandsound.com. We'll put a link down below. Our courses cover everything from production sound techniques to using popular field recorders to the fundamentals of video lighting. And proceeds from these courses cover the production costs for the videos here on the channel. So if you find our content useful, please consider heading over to school.learnlightandsound.com and buy yourself a course. Also, full disclosure, IK Multimedia gave ARC Studio to me to make this video. They have not paid me beyond providing the gear. They have not told me what to say and have not reviewed this video prior to posting. Let's go. Most people just mix audio for video on headphones today, right? So most of our audiences listen to our videos on headphones or earbuds or even mobile speakers or laptop speakers. So what's the point of even using speakers to mix your audio monitors? Well, I will say this for one thing, as a working audio and video professional, I can't work in headphones all day long with their clamping force on my head, two electromagnetic fields right against my head, just not comfortable all day long. I do definitely mix in headphones to some extent, but I got to get out of them at some point and also listen to some speakers. And also, some of the audience will listen on speakers, even if they're not great speakers. So just buying an amazing set of reference monitors or speakers isn't an ace in the hole in terms of making great mixes. And the question is why? And that's because the room in which you use those speakers defines the sound you ultimately hear. The sound reflects off of the walls, it builds up or even creates destructive and constructive interference, making the sound in that room anything but even, flat, or uncolored, even with the most expensive near-field monitors. So that's why you see most mix rooms that are treated with broadband traps, or sometimes they're called bass traps. And yeah, that makes a huge difference, but isn't that enough? And it's definitely a great improvement, but treatment, especially for small rooms like most of us are working in, it isn't perfect. It does a good job. It helps. It's a step, but it's not perfect. And that's where room correction systems come in. And that's what we're going to talk about here today. So to set the stage for that, a couple years ago, I posted one of my least popular video reviews ever in terms of the number of views it got, and that was a review of something called SonarWorks SoundID Reference. It's a room correction system that's an app that runs on your computer, and it works like this. You run an app with a reference microphone attached to your audio interface, and the app guides you where to place that mic in your room, and then it plays sounds across the audible spectrum through your monitors, through your speakers, and that microphone measures the acoustic characteristics of your room. So after 30-some positions, it has a pretty good picture of the acoustic situation in your room, which frequencies are being overrepresented, which are underrepresented, which frequencies are taking a lot longer to decay, and how long they're taking. Then it runs an app on your computer that essentially adapts all the sounds sent to your speakers to compensate for your room's acoustic signature. And that should result in more even, less colored sound. And let me be clear, no room correction system is perfect, but they help, and every little bit of help adds up. And for the record, I advocate for the use of proper dense acoustic treatment and room correction together, if at all possible. But if that's not possible, at least use one of the two. Most will probably choose room correction systems because they're more affordable, and especially if you're living in a rented space, they're less imposing, and it's just an easier way to do it. But all that aside, I ran into problems with SoundID Reference. It worked fine some of the time, and other times it just wouldn't work at all. And when it did work, it was amazing what it did to my room. It cleared up especially the lower frequencies in a way that made it so much easier to understand and hear what was going on, and so much easier to get to the mix I wanted to. So what was going on is I think that updates to my operating system would disable the app, and then I'd update the app a few weeks or months later when a new version became available, and it would start working again. And then at some point again, it would stop, and I spent several hours trying to troubleshoot it, finally gave up. And let me just say, the software is amazing. I work at a software company. Software companies can create their apps, update their apps, they can apply bug fixes, and they can even add new features. But it can also be a pain because apps like room correction software have to operate pretty deeply in the operating system, and operating system updates can break things. And sadly, I think that's my personal experience with SoundID Reference. I think that was going on, but the end result was it just wasn't reliable. I couldn't rely on it to actually do what I needed it to do. So I started researching other options out there, and I came across IK Multimedia's ARC Studio, ARC standing for Advanced Room Correction. And what made it different is that instead of running an app on your computer to apply the room correction, you place a piece of hardware between your audio interface and your monitors. And that piece of hardware, once it's been programmed with the room correction details for your room, doesn't even have to be connected to your computer via USB. It just takes care of the compensation like a piece of standalone audio gear that doesn't care whether you're even using a computer. The kit comes with the ARC Studio unit, a plastic reference microphone. Now, so you'll think a plastic microphone? And it has a MEMS capsule for those that care about things like that, but it seems to do a great job. It also comes with a microphone stand clip and a USB cable. And the way this works is pretty much like SoundID reference. You run an app that walks you through the room measurement process, which takes either 7 or 21 measurements. 21 will be more accurate, at least in theory. Then you transfer the correction data to the ARC Studio via USB. At that point, you no longer need to keep the ARC Studio connected to your computer. You just run the outputs from your audio interface over into the ARC, and then XLR cables from the ARC to your monitors. And that's it. You can turn on the correction with a single button on the ARC Studio, or you can turn it back off with that same button. And that's literally all there is to it. And I'll say this, it works well. It works as well as SoundID Reference worked, when SoundID Reference did work. The bass response is so much cleaner and easier to make out. I had some pretty substantial boominess and muddiness in my room, making it hard to make mixing decisions, especially for the lower frequencies. But it clears all that up nicely. So it works really, really well. So the question I'll need to come back and answer is, in 12 months from now, has ARC Studio worked reliably? So I'll add a pinned comment down below when we get there. Now, does SoundID Reference have anything that ARC Studio doesn't? And the answer to that is actually, yes, it does. It also does headphone correction. Unfortunately, ARC Studio doesn't do that, at least not presently. But again, if I couldn't get it working reliably, it just isn't much help. And so I'm just curious, if you've had a better experience with SoundID Reference or SonarWorks, let us know in the comments down below. I'm just one data point, so I'm not here to say that SoundID Reference is horrible. Just my experience hasn't been great, and maybe there's something wrong with my computer, I don't know. Is there anything I didn't love about ARC Studio? Well, this is a little bit nitpicky, but the wall wart power adapter, it works nicely if you're plugging into a wall or power strip that's oriented vertically, but it's not great for power strips or maybe power conditioners where they're oriented more horizontally. So it's not a huge deal, but it can be an annoyance in some situations. Now, ARC Studio runs $299 USD at the time of this review, and you'll also need two additional XLR cables because, again, you're going to kind of insert this in between your audio interface and your speakers. But that's a pretty reasonable price, and for me, absolutely worth the cost. Hope that helps. Get out there, make some great sound, and we will talk to you again soon.